I'm very pleased to introduce Dr. Jose Ocana. Dr. Ocana has a prolific career in, as a professor, and I'm gonna mispronounce this, Jose, but it's the ETSIIUPM School of Engineering. He's the director of the UPM Laser Center at the university. Dr. Ocana is an active promoter and participant in the national and worldwide R&D initiatives in the field of science and industry, industrial applications of high power lasers, especially high intensity lasers, matter interaction, laser welding, laser surface treatments, and laser micro machining, laser additive manufacturing, online monitoring, and control of industrial applications. He is also author and co-author of more than 200 scientific papers and more than 250 communications in the field of technology and application. Welcome, Dr. Ocana. We're looking forward to your talk, and we'll have questions at the end. So please proceed with your presentation for today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Larman. I would like, first of all, to express my sincere thanks to the organizers of the seminar, this laser shop pinning virtual event. And I would like to express my sincere thanks and congratulations to Dr. Alan Clower, the first speaker yesterday, for his really enlightening talk about the origin of the technology. Without all these developments he and co-workers promote at the beginning, at the starting point of the technology, many of the developments afterwards would sincerely not have been possible. So I appreciate very much Dr. Clower, his vital effort for the development of laser shock processing technology, and just give him a tribute of my gratitude on that. As an academic person, I appreciate really very much the way in which he introduced the different concepts together with historical reasons. So it's really enlightening. Okay, I will present today to the audience a subject that is not very many times dealt with, which is the predictive assessment of residual stress fields induced by LSP. So it is clear that from the engineering point of view, an important point for the evaluation of the capability of laser pinning of introducing some benefit into the materials is just to check the performance of the specimens in typical engineering tests, as mostly fatigue tests and corrosion tests. And sometimes some intermediate measurements of residual stresses are made. But it is clear, and some talk yesterday was in the same direction, it is needed to have some predictive assessment of the benefits that the LSP can introduce into the materials in order to proceed with a clear design phase for the implementation, for the true implementation of the technique into an industrial environment. So modeling is really a need, and the way in which modeling is applied to real life components is substantial in order to anticipate the real behavior of these components, and in order not to damage the components by the treatment, but much on the contrary, to have the properties improved by the treatment. So my talk is in this sense to analyze two main topics in the predictive assessment of the final residual stress fields induced in materials, as are the laser interaction, which is a key point and not many times dealt with, and also the material behavior models that we can introduce into the modeling. Into the modeling activities, into the design activities. So Okay, the motivation is that I have referred to, and the concrete thing is that the practical achievement of these protective residual stress fields in real components is sometimes burdened by a lack of physical understanding of the material transformations that are inside by the effect of laser interaction and the subsequent process design capability. In particular, the correct estimation of the temporal evolution of the plasma pressure that is the responsibility of driving the material shock is crucial because of the pressure that is built up by the effect of the plasma and its comparison to the Hugoniot elastic limit of the material at any at each moment, which is which can be variable, and this must be considered. This is considered as critical for the prediction of the final effect of the treatment on the material. Additionally, some other effects, as for example, the cyclic strain stress evolution of the material in extended treatment that are, for example, made with the overlapping pulses when you need to guarantee some uniformity of the treatment also pose some difficulties from the point of view of simulating the behavior from the numerical point of view as they establish some difficult correlations between the stress and the strain when the deformation of the material is not only once, but is repeated from the overlapping pulse point of view. Then the main work of our group at the Polytechnical University of Madrid for several years has been the development of a modeling, processing, testing approach, trying to obtain some integrated model for realistic predictive assessment of the process. Of course, as I will comment in the last view graphs, this is not a complete path because you can always have the difficulty of correlating what we observe from the macroscopic point of view in terms of residual stresses and fatigue life assessment, for example, with the microstructure. In this point, the talk yesterday by Dr. Plauer was especially enlightening, even though he didn't cite explicitly the correlation or did not very frequently the correlation between the predictions of the codes to the microstructure. He made clear that this correlation is really the key for the development of appropriate treatments. The outline of my presentation after this short motivation is to analyze, not all, this doesn't pretend to be exhaustive, of course, because we have limited time, but I will point out two critical aspects in the predictive assessment of LSP treatments as we consider them. We think that the two main aspects are the shock pressure and thermal waves build up because of the laser interaction with the plasma. And second, this analysis of the material elastic plastic behavior. And because they are major effects, not the only, but the major effects that condition very clearly, as you will see, the effect of laser onto the material and determine the evolution, the real evolution of the material after laser interaction. So after that, we will go to the development of some methods for the experimentally validated assessment of this precisely these two effects. First, the plasma behavior and pressure and thermal buildup, just driving the process into the material, and also how to model and what are the tendencies in the elastic plastic behavior model of materials under cyclic loading, which is a must when you use overlapping pulses, as is in the case of low energy lasers or relatively low energy lasers applied to LSP treatment. After that, we will profit for the presentation of or the comment of the integrated predictive assessment model that has been developed at our center, just trying to justify the integration of all these improvements or these methods, just in order to predict real life situations. And I will present some examples, and I hope it will be clear how the appropriate modeling of the processes is critical for the final process design. Finally, I will discuss and present some open problems that must be solved for the future. So just in order to use these diagrams afterwards and to make clear what is really the scenario we are talking about. We assume that the laser shock processing principle is the application of a pressure on the normal phase of a material, and the material correspondingly expands due to the elastic plastic properties of this material. And after the pressure exerted by the plasma is released, the material reacts just recompressing the treated zone. But taking into account that maybe this deformation has been not only elastic, but also plastic, and that the recovering of this stress leaves the material with the desired residual stresses. This is made through the laser interaction, normally through a confining layer that is supporting the expansion of the plasma and thus providing the pressure pulse that is applied to the material being larger in duration than the laser pulse itself. This is shown here schematically. And this behavior of the stresses into the material as applied in the normal direction and how the transverse direction is reacting can be tentatively and schematically seen in the so-called von Mises diagram, in which any elastic load below the Hugoniot elastic limit produces some elastic recovery. But once you reach a certain level of lateral expansion, you reach a plastic deformation level. And then this plastic deformation level finally leaves the material with the corresponding residual stresses. In fact, this is the ideal diagram which is sought by the application of laser pinning. So to deformate the material, not only elastically, but also a certain limit to plastic load, and after that to recover this load in an elastic way, followed by a plastic unload, just leaving the material compressed in the transverse direction. So this is what is normally sought by laser pinning from a material, an ideal material point of view. So what are the critical aspects in the shock pressure and thermal waves buildup? So the most simple treatment of the pressure buildup into the gap between the material and the confining layer, just in order, maybe the confining layer could be the void, as we will see in some articles, in some references, but normally the most simple diagram for taking into account the buildup of pressure is that due to Fournier in 1989, which is really simple, assuming that the effect of the laser is just to ionize the plasma and that the ionization of this plasma in a very short time is provoking the formation of two complementary shock waves, so one In the confining layer towards the incident laser, but the other one into the material. According to some deductions, the estimation of the correlation between the laser intensity and the pressure developed into the material is obtained. And finally, the solution of this differential equation leads to a very simple result in which you can obtain explicitly the pressure generated against time. So if the pressure, if the intensity applied is ideally constant, we obtain the very well-known formula that was published by Favreau in 1999, but in the general case, this is not the real solution, and the real solution must be obtained by direct application of this correlation if you stay in this simple picture. The idea is that not always you are able to obtain this maximum level of maximum pressure generated, but if your laser has some temporal profile, you need to consider it explicitly in order to obtain the final profile, temporal profile of your pressure pulse. And this is one of the most important points. And not only the maximum level of pressure pulse generated, but also the decay curve of this pressure pulse over time, because this has to be compared to the Hugoniot elastic limit, because during all the time that this pressure decay is overcoming, is overcoming the Hugoniot elastic limit, the material is being deformed plastically. And so it's really important. This is really important to assess the decay rate of this pressure pulse over time in order to know how much time is the material being deformed, not only elastically, but also plastically. And this is one of the main points that is not very easily estimated by the pulses and has an inherent difficulty to be estimated from the experimental point of view. In particular, very long time ago, ourselves, we were able to make observations, direct observation by umbroscopy of the decay rate. But I must confess that this is a very difficult task always because of the calibration of the systems. I will talk about it afterwards. And finally, the hypothesis on the model just allowing one rate or another is maybe very difficult to estimate. So from the, an experimental point of view, the correlation between the experimental data and the theoretical approach is always difficult. And another point that is really into play is that provided the laser intensity is high, some saturation effect or breakdown effect is observed, so that experimental points show very clearly that the maximum level of pressure that can be achieved, which was initially calculated by Pirri in 73, follows this this curve. In reality, it's not a real case, because at a certain level of peak intensity, the value of the maximum press that can be generated clearly saturates because of breakdown. So this is also very difficult to predict, but from an empirical point of view, it can be estimated that if you fix, for example, the level for the appearance of breakdown, you can see clearly that the theoretical curve by Pirri or other researchers can be directly converted to a clearly saturated curve that is taken into account of this breakdown. So these things, the dielectric breakdown, and also the way the hypothesis for the evaluation of the decay of the pressure generated are the two main points that can be observed into the laser plasma interaction. What is the case for the material elastic plastic behavior? In the case of repeated treatment, in order to produce some uniform effect of residual stresses, you can see here the case, you obtain this cyclic plasticity behavior of the material, very well known. In the case of some particular alloys and thermal treatments, you obtain these cycles, for example, for the first compression, but for the second and successive compressions, you obtain these different cycles. This is a problem because when you go to the Hugoniot curve, when you repeat the process, once you obtain your final solution for the first point, you obtain something like this. So you obtain some kind of ratcheting for the stresses into this diagram, Hugoniot diagram. And if you go to much many pulse deformation repeated pulses, you obtain very clearly this effect of ratcheting that finally are changing the Hugoniot elastic limit at each new pulse. This must be taken into account because you can obtain with traditional material modeling, typically the Johnson-Cook approach, you obtain this kind of behavior. This for the first compression, but if you go to the cyclic compression at each new step, you will reach a maximum level of saturation, and so on and so on. So your estimation of the compressive residual stresses you are reaching is overestimated, very clearly overestimated, and this kind of models can no longer be used if you wish some kind of precision. So the next point is just to show some methods we have developed for the experimentally validated assessment of both the plasma behavior and then the elastic plastic behavior of the material. So let's go first with the plasma behavior. Plasma behavior is really difficult. Here I just show an illustrative view graph by Gibbon, provided in 2005. And we have here the laser. There are a lot of mechanisms by which the laser energy is absorbed. And then once it has been absorbed, it is transformed through the fluid equations plus equation of states that generate the pressure that is depending on the ionization and the temperature. The density, which is influenced by the ionization and the temperature. And this complex diagram is interrelated. So in general, the idea of controlling the plasma is really a difficult point. And must rely always in the contrast to experimental data. So this must be provided always in the facility you have. This is the facility at our center. You around the treatment itself, you must provide the appropriate conceptual interrelated diagnostic system that, for example, takes into account the temperature and density of the plasma, the velocity of expansion, the spectroscopy in order to see the species and how the ionization proceeds. So many traces that are all necessary to fit, to adjust the programs for the simulation of the plasma itself. So it's not easy to simulate the plasma without any contrast or any checking, any correlation to experimental traces. And this is one of the most important difficulties for the modeling of the plasma expansion and the correlation between the intensity of the laser to the plasma pressure. This was one, I remember, one of the points precisely that Dr. Klauer stressed yesterday, the correlation between their simulation code, LILA code, and the effects obtained finally in the materials. Unfortunately, he couldn't have the intermediate point of evaluating the pressure onto the material and the residual stresses. But finally, some kind of correlation was obtained. It was very good, as he reported, but the intermediate point is just to have a model able to predict the pressure pulse that is really applied to the material. So some traces are shown like that. For example, this kind of waves that can be observed. It's a pity because these were supposed to run in real time, but okay, you can see here how this density can be evaluated, how the sound speed is reached so that it's demonstrated the presence of shock waves, and how the density and temperature of the plasma can be evaluated from a spectroscopic point of view. What is really difficult because you need to overcome the effect of several shielding of the plasma. So it's very difficult to go inside the plasma itself, and you need to observe it from outside. So you need to take into account the self-absorption or self-shielding by the plasma, and then to have some correlation. So by means of our developments, we have obtained preliminary estimations of temperatures in the range of several thousand Kelvin after the shutdown in longer times, because it's very hard to obtain then in shorter times. But it's very clearly, we have been able to clearly correlate the density and temperature effects of the plasma on the final pressure that can be obtained. We have made also estimations of the dielectric breakdown for different wavelengths, different interaction times. Unfortunately, for the interaction times available in the lasers we use for laser pinning that are otherwise needed for obtaining the appropriate transport of energy by shock waves, we find that the threshold for breakdown is very, very low, as only several gigawatts per square centimeter. We have a threshold for breakdown, what minimizes the possibility of obtaining very high pressures just by increasing the intensity of the lasers. So this increasing of the energy of the intensity of the lasers is useful because we obtain some dielectric breakdown on these levels when you reach, for example, to 10 gigawatts per square centimeter. So with all this in mind, and also the thresholds developed by breakdown, we have been able to reproduce analytically the situation for the experimental data and estimate the effective pulse duration for different values of laser intensity. So here it's clear that you can reach a full pulse duration only below 10 gigawatts per square centimeter, but the pulse duration is much lower after that. And finally, we feed all this data into our simulation model, which is a radiation hydrodynamics code, as the LILA code Dr. Klauer mentioned yesterday. And finally, we are able to obtain these traces these pressure pulses that are applied to the material. We can change different confining media, we can change different material by their properties, we can change the confining layer for different hypotheses, and we can see, for example, the case of air or vacuum conditions is no longer providing high level of intensity, and for example, these are the comparative cases of water and glass. And this is very well known, but we just obtained as a sample that our estimation was correct. And at the same time, this is also very important, we can obtain a temporal correlation, a time correlation between the pressure pulse, which is the nominal and the one that everyone is talking about, but also we have the effect of a thermal pulse, a heat flux that is being communicated to the target. So fortunately, this thermal pulse is produced with some delay in general with respect to the pressure pulse. And that's why it's only important at very short distances below the surface of the material. But this, of course, must be taken into account. So what is the idea? To fit all these results, to fit all these results into the integrated simulation code. What about the elastic plastic behavior of materials? The thing I have remarked in advance, normally we use the Johnson-Kuhn model. This is the traditional, but we have seen that this model must be changed and complemented by other type of models, taking into account not only the incremental deformation, but also the level of deformation itself. In this way, we have been able, and this is published, and we have been able to reproduce very closely the real behavior and to obtain some additional constants for the behavior of the material, additional to the Johnson-Kuhn constants. So the Johnson-Kuhn constants are strictly isotropic, but the model must be at least kinematic of first order. There are several orders. All the details can be found in this publication. And in order to obtain the real behavior of the material. But as a single sample, we have seen that the residual stresses that you obtain with your isotropic, at this Johnson-Kuhn model, are overestimated over the realistic combining hardening that are obtained here. And as a proof of the application to real situation, we see how the realistic simulation is more tending to the combined model, the proposed model, than to the purely isotropic, that is the Johnson-Kuhn model. So we have made some findings of this type that are approaching ourselves to the real, to the experimental situation.
Got 4 minutes.
Yeah. Then what about the inclusion of all these improvements on the integrated predictive assessment model? So the all the features I have been mentioning are integrated on our combined simulation model. And the idea is just to fit all this microscopic data and this microscopic modeling data into realistic target geometry and overlapping strategy models. And this is the work we have been done. We have been doing with the development of some practical applications. Different materials, we can very clearly see the evolution of the stresses into the material in our simulations, but not only in a simplified geometry. We can treat real geometries, and we can assess the degree of uniformity of the residual stresses. It's very clearly very well known that if you apply a very low density of pulses your uniformity is not very good, and that you need a large amount of overlapping pulses in order to get some uniformity in the treatment of a zone. We have applied this methodology to predict the residual stresses in different directions of real components. We have made some studies in cooperation with some colleagues. For example, I show here some results obtained for some work pieces proposed by Airbus. They are published. And we have the capability. Unfortunately, I think they are not working. Normally, they were working, and you can see the stresses and the deformation evolution. But finally, our main contrast is just to achieve residual stress profiles that are comparable to experiment. And with all these improvements in mind, we are increasingly comparing favorably to experiments. So for the case cited below of this through thickness and residual stresses for these thin plates, we have obtained a very close correlation between simulation and experimental data. And this allows us to use the technique to simulate more complex components in a fully three-dimensional scale. So this is the schematics of what we are doing, going from basics to final application, and again, cycling the procedure up to the obtention of a very clear correlation between theory and experiments. So as conclusion, we are able to obtain methods increasingly better for the checking against experimental results. We think this is a very clear pathway to be followed in order to obtain a very clear design capability for real life components, and that all these models are needed to be implemented if you really want a realistic way or for simulation of your real geometry components. Don't forget that the real life components are not always specimens, are not always very typified turbine blades. Maybe components are very difficult in geometry sometimes, and you need to assess with a certain capability of success all these applications of residual stresses, protective residual stresses, into the components. Otherwise, maybe you destroy the component, or even worse, you think the component has been benefited from the treatment, and this is not the case, which is much, much worse. But even in this case, there are a lot of open challenges envisaged for real scale process design. I understand that the first most critical is the correlation of all these results I am presenting that are referring to modeling codes, simulation codes that finally have the hypothesis of continuous mechanics modeling. You need to correlate that definitely to microstructure, mechanical properties, high rate experiments, and so on. So the connection between these macroscopic models to what is microscopic physics is absolutely needed. And otherwise, one important point is the experimental validation of two-dimensional model-based laser plasma interaction, which is one difficult topic that must be overcome by the effort, unfortunately. So with this, I recall the principal problem is just to predictively assess the comparison between the plasma pressure exerted into the material with the material properties of the workpiece itself. And this is one main point that can be summarized in this view graph, but that has a lot of issues, as previously said. So these are basic references of our work. and our work has been supported by Spanish institutions, normally the Ministry of Science and Economy. So thank you very much for your attention. I hope you find useful what I have just presented here.
Thank you, Dr. O'Connor.